shot?
Nope.
So go ahead and tell us your name, your correct title, and how long you've been at the district.
Well, my name is Gwendolyn Moore. I am the curator of Urban Landscapes and Community Identity, and I have been at the History Museum since 2004, the second time. Okay.
What was the first time?
Well, the first time I came here, I was a research fellow, and I worked on an exhibit doing oral histories through the eyes of a child. I then worked as a programmer. I did the Urban Forum series for the History Museum, and then I went off to graduate school and came back in 2004.
Where did you go for graduate school?
Indiana University.
Okay. Mm-hmm. How did you like
it? I loved Bloomington.
Yeah.
Very peaceful place.
Yeah. The original chair of my dissertation committee, that's where he got his doctorate.
Ah.
And I visited Bloomington once to interview Walt Harrington, who was a narrative journalist. I think he originally worked for the Washington Post, but he's a really good writer. He taught them. And I thought Bloomington was a really nice, only spent a few days there.
It is a very pleasant place.
Are you good?
Well, you're concerned about the door?
Yeah.
Can we tell people not to come through the door?
I have a sign, or I can prop that door open, but it was also a back door, which I don't know if people are coming. But go ahead.
Okay. Let's try to see if we hit it at the right time. So why don't you start by just telling us how you came up with the idea for this exhibit?
Well, it really started, if I'm going to go way back, I'm going to give you the long version of the story. It started really in 2004. It's when I came back to the History Museum, and I was working on a Teaching American History grant, and I was charged with doing an oral history of the Civil Rights Movement. And in the course of doing this research, I learned a lot about the Civil Rights Movement in St. Louis. And of course, with oral history, you have to interview people who are alive. And so I decided that I was going to focus on youth activism. Number one, it was for schools and for teachers, and I thought it would be something that young people would be interested in, to see young people who were involved in the civil rights movement. So that particular project focused on the NAACP Youth Council under the leadership of Margaret Bush Wilson and Frederick Witherspoon in 1959 and 1961-62. And I also looked at CORE, early CORE, because a lot of WashU students were involved in that early CORE civil rights organization. So that's how it got started. And of course, during the course of that research, I came across Judge Nathan B. Young, who was one of the founders of the St. Louis American newspaper and had a really keen interest in African-American history, local African-American history, and did a lot of research. Now, as the founder of the African-American newspaper, which is the St. Louis American, he was also the editor for the next 40, 45 years. And a lot of his editorials actually dealt with local civil rights history. I always say that his editorials are like mini history lessons. I've learned a lot about African American history just from reading his editorials. But in 1964, there was a bicentennial issue, September the 22nd, 1964. And he wrote a very long article about the contributions of African Americans to the city of St. Louis and to the nation. Not just African Americans, but he also talked about the contributions of whites who were involved in the freedom struggles of African Americans. And one of the reasons he wrote this long article is because he wanted the city of St. Louis, in this celebration of the bicentennial, don't forget what we have contributed. Don't forget what African Americans have contributed. And he had this very bold headline, number one city in civil rights, which I'm sure caught a lot of people's attention. But the interesting thing is, he went on to build a very strong case to support his argument. And I was very impressed and influenced by his work, and set out to to research some of the assertions that he was making and found out that a lot of them were true.
So when you tell people about this exhibit or the article, the title Number One in Civil Rights, what is their first reaction?
Well, the first reaction is, we didn't even have a civil rights movement. In fact, this happened in 2004 when I was talking about my work on the oral history of the civil rights movement, and there was this feeling that we really didn't have a civil rights movement. I think it has a lot to do with the way local history is taught or is not taught in the public schools. I think it also has to do with the fact that many people think of civil rights movement as something that happened in the Deep South, beginning in 1954 and ending in 1968. And they don't think of Missouri. They think of Alabama and Mississippi and Georgia and the Deep South states. But there was a civil rights movement here, a very active civil rights movement, and a very rich civil rights movement. And according to Judge Young, we can date it to 1819, which is a very bold claim. And that's because he said in 1918, we had the first civil rights demonstration on the continent when free blacks and their white allies were protesting the fact that Missouri was going to enter the Union as a slave state. So it starts there. And then he goes on to build his case. You know, he doesn't stop there. And the crux of his argument is that at least in 1964, that our contribution to the national movement was these three civil rights cases. That was in 1964. And the first one was 1857, of course, the Dred Scott case, which practically everyone knows, one of the most famous court cases in United States history, Supreme Court cases. But there were also the other cases. In 1938, there was Gaines versus Canada, when Lloyd Gaines sued the University of Missouri because they would not allow him to enter the law school there because he was a Negro. And then the Shelley versus Kramer case, which is when the Shelleys sued because of a restrictive covenant that tried to prevent them from living in a house they had purchased in the 4600 block of Labadie. But then again in 1968, there was another Supreme Court case, Jones versus Meyer. And so Judge Young, as he was such very much focused on these civil rights cases, says, aha, not only did we have three civil rights cases that made it all the way to the Supreme Court, now we have a fourth one, Jones versus Meyer, in which Joseph and Barbara Lee Jones sued Alfred H. Meyer because he would not sell them a house in Paddock Woods, which is a subdivision in North St. Louis County, because Mr. Jones was a Negro. Barbara Jones was white. Now, the interesting thing about this case is that Alfred Meyer really wanted to sell them the house, but because of all these restrictions, these racial restrictions, he was prevented from doing so. He was a businessman. Now, I don't know if he had a moral conscience, but he definitely wanted to make money, and he wanted to sell to everybody. And he actually helped to finance this case secretly, of course, a case that was against him. So I thought that was really interesting, and it shows how this is not just a one-sided story. It's not about blacks fighting for their rights. That's a big part of the story. But they also had white allies from the very beginning, and there were always whites of goodwill that were involved in this struggle.
So Judge Young talked about the Supreme Court cases. He talked about the early protest. What else is sort of part of the St. Louis civil rights movement that maybe he didn't mention in his column, but that you feel like are some of the important moments?
Well, he talked about so much. Like he talked about, for example, the first Emancipation Proclamation in 1862 that happened before Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation that happened right here in St. Louis. I'm not sure if he talked about this whole fight to end segregated streetcars in St. Louis. And I think this is an interesting story. Because St. Louis, I always say that St. Louis is different from the Deep South story, because St. Louis is different from the Deep South. We had this sort of strange history. We were a segregated city. We had Jim Crow. But it was never legal. The only legally restrictive laws, only racially restrictive laws on the books, were a law that prevented blacks and whites from going to school together, mandated segregated schools. And there was the other law that said that blacks and whites could not marry, but also it said whites and what they called at the time Mongolians could not marry. But other than that, there were no laws that says blacks can't go to a movie theater, blacks can't go to a restaurant, blacks can't ride on streetcars, they have to go to the back of the bus. We didn't have those laws. But it was custom and tradition. Well, one of those customs and traditions was challenged right after the Civil War, practically, in 1867, when blacks started suing because they were not allowed to ride on the inside of streetcars. It wasn't a law. It was just practice and custom. So we had suits. I can't remember the first suit was 1867. I can't remember the man's name, but he did sue and he was successful. But I do remember the second suit, and I also always remember that second suit because of the name of the litigants, who were Neptune and Caroline Williams. That's a name that sticks in your head. And they sued in 1868 because Caroline Williams, who was pregnant and supposedly had a babe in her arms, was not allowed on the inside of that car. And the story varies, but she was pushed or ejected in some way, and they sued and they won. They got an injunction that you could not bar blacks from sitting on the inside of the car, and they also won. They asked for damages, and they won nominal damages, not what they asked for. They asked for thousands, and they got, the story says, a penny, but it was a damage. It was a moral victory, and it was a legal victory. But like I said, just because a law is passed, it has to be enforced. And the person that's given a lot of credit for enforcing that law is Charlton Tandy. Tandy, it is said, he organized sit-ins, according to Herman Dreer. Herman Dreer is another one of these early black historians that people might have forgotten about. Herman Dreer even said that he organized sit-ins, which was unheard of, I think, in 1890s, 1870s. He would go so far as to grab the reins of the horse when a streetcar driver tried to pass up a black passenger, and he would not let that horse move and let that streetcar move until blacks were allowed to go into that streetcar and sit wherever they so choose. So that was one part of the city of St. Louis where desegregation was not a part of our history. You know, in the South, that was a big battle. Rosa Parks, she did not want to go to the back of that bus. That was never a problem here. So that was one battle that we didn't have to fight. Another battle that we didn't have to fight was for the franchise. Now, with the passage of the 15th Amendment, Missouri and St. Louis, of course, accepted that blacks could vote. There were no grandfather clauses like there were in the South. No literacy requirements, no poll taxes, no property restrictions. So blacks could always vote. So that was also a fight that we did not have to have. And we could channel our resources to other places. And I think that makes us different from the Deep South as well. So that's why our story is different. And maybe that's why people don't recognize the civil rights movement in St. Louis as they do in other places, because our fight was different.
How are they?
Well, one of the big, I think housing has been a problem. It started with the 1916 residential segregation fight. In 1914, the city had a new charter, and it was a progressive reform that gave the citizens the right to put initiatives on the ballot. Well, this progressive reform resulted in an initiative that wasn't so progressive, because the first ballot initiative was to restrict where blacks could live in the city of St. Louis. They wanted to residentially segregate blacks. So that was a big fight. That was, I would say, the first big fight of the 20th century here in St. Louis in 1916. And unfortunately, that residential segregation law did pass. However, a similar law that had gone to the Supreme Court was ruled unconstitutional, so that law never went into effect. That law probably never would have gone into effect anyway, because George Vaughn, Charles Pittman, who was the president of the local NAACP, and Homer G. Phillips had gotten an injunction that would have prevented that law from going into effect. And I think I should mention that Judge David Dyer was the person who entered, he'll come up later in the exhibit, who issued that injunction that would have prevented this law from going into effect. So that was a big one. And of course, you have the Shelley versus Kramer case, which I don't know if I've mentioned that already, but that was dealt with restrictive covenants. The first restrictive covenants were probably started being issued around 1904, and the bulk of them were issued in 1920. And basically what would happen is that people in certain blocks would get together and they say, we will not sell our house to a Negro or a Mongolian, an Asian. And this was the case with the 4600 block of Labadee, where the Shelleys had bought a house in 1945, and the Kramers sued to prevent them from going, from taking ownership of this house. That the restrictive covenant was, I think, issued in 1911, and wasn't supposed to expire for 50 years. So, of course, this was 1945, so that was covered. So James Bush, who was the father of Margaret Bush Wilson and an influential realtor, financed this case. And it went back and forth. George Vaughn, who was also involved in the residential segregation fight, was the lawyer for these cases. And this was not an isolated case. George Vaughn argued a lot of these cases for black realtors who were fighting against these restrictive covenants before the Shelley versus Kramer case. And he handled a lot of these cases, so he was very familiar with it. And he won. He won until it went all the way, and it went all the way to the Supreme Court. And that again is a fascinating story, because they had such faith. People here in St. Louis had such faith in George Vaughn. Of course, this was part of the NAACP strategy, and the National was giving assistance. Well, the National didn't think that George Vaughn had the legal chops to handle this case. And of course, they had Thurgood Marshall and Charles Hamilton Houston. You know, these Charles Hamilton Houston was a Harvard Law School graduate. He had taught Thurgood Marshall. He'd established the law school at Howard University, and his goal was to make Howard University Law School on par with Harvard. He established the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. Just an amazing black lawyer. Well, these were the people that wanted to handle this case. And compared to Vaughn, who had gone to Walden University Law School in Nashville, Tennessee. I don't know much about Walden University Law School, but I'm sure it's not on par with Harvard. But they insisted. And they said, no, he's been our lawyer. He's handled this case through the lower courts. He's handled other cases for us. We are sticking with him. And I think that says a lot about our leadership here in St. Louis, that they did not cave, and they supported George Vaughn, and he argued this case all the way to the Supreme Court. Of course, he had assistance. Nobody, just one person, argues that case. And he won. And so that was the second, in the 20th century, that was the second landmark case. And then the final case, of course, was Jones versus Meyer.
Streetcar protest. If you go to textbooks or on the web, it'll oftentimes say the civil rights movement is 1954 to 1968. Talk about why you think it's important to talk about those earlier times.
Well, you know, I think the struggle didn't start in 54. I think it's important to show that this was an ongoing struggle. I wanted to show that people have always fought against injustice and always fought against inequality, and it started with slavery. I mean, the freedom suits. I'm not sure if Judge Young talked about those, but the freedom suits. In fact, I was reading a fairly recent book about the freedom suits here in Missouri, because there were so many. And that was when an enslaved person could sue for their freedom on the basis that they were wrongfully enslaved. And one of the what was fascinating about this, you know, it was the 1807 territorial law when this was first established. But then in 1824, this woman called Winnie, and we don't know her last name, but she sued her owners, the Whitesides, because she said that she had been living in Illinois, in Northwest Territory, and based on the fact that she lived in free territory, she was free. This case went through the courts, and she won, and it established a judicial precedent. Once free, always free. And over 300 of these freedom suits were filed in St. Louis courts. And I can't remember off the top of my head how many were won, but quite a few were won. And this was really, really important. And they're actually referred to as early civil rights cases. So even though we don't think of civil rights as going back to what Judge Young says was 1819, or freedom suits in the 1820s, and even before, they really were civil rights because they were based on the fact that I am a citizen. They're defining their citizenship. And because I am a citizen, I have certain citizenship rights, which is what civil rights are all about. And I thought it was interesting. One of the things that I wanted to include was a quote from Elijah P. Lovejoy, who, of course, is another important figure, white Presbyterian minister who was the editor of a newspaper called the St. Louis Observer, who was run out of the city of St. Louis after he wrote this many, many articles and editorials condemning the fact that Francis McIntosh was lynched. But he was anti-slavery, and he said that it was a violation of civil rights. He was using this term in 1836. So this is not a term that's new. It's not a term that started with 54. It was a term that people recognized and used in the 19th century and maybe even before. It's just that my research doesn't go back that far.
What about that modern period, 1954 on? Does St. Louis have an equally compelling story about civil rights during that period?
Oh, I think so. I think so. Well, there was, of course, there was the fight to integrate the schools, and St. Louis was definitely a part of that, making sure that, the schools were integrated. A long, slow fight, but it was a fight. But then there was the Jefferson Bank demonstrations, what I'm sure that many, many people know about. It was what Margaret Bush Wilson said was a defining moment in St. Louis. It was the longest, largest civil rights battle in the city of St. Louis, and it involved so many groups and so many people, blacks and whites. It involved a large community, and it went on for over a year. Then I like the story of FIRE. FIRE is the Firefighters Institute for Racial Equality. And this was a group of firefighters who decided that they could not accept the fact that they were being discriminated against within the fire department. And they founded this organization, and they called it a civil rights organization because they said they were fighting for their civil rights. They sued the city of St. Louis in 1968, and they fought four successive city administrations, and they finally won a consent decree that really I wouldn't say it ended discrimination within the city of St. Louis Fire Department, but it really ordered the city to promote blacks to the positions of fire captains, battalion chiefs, so forth and so on. So they won a major battle. And I think that's an organization that is still around today, and I think a lot of people don't realize the pioneering work that they did. I think they had an impact not just within the city of St. Louis, but on job discrimination with throughout the city. I think whenever you make these advancements, whenever you win these battles, it doesn't just help your particular group, it's not an individual thing. It redounds to everyone. And I think that's important for people to understand. Margaret Bush Wilson tells this story that I find very interesting. But, of course, she was very much involved in the Jefferson Bank demonstrations, was one of the lawyers for the defendants. And she tells the story about years later, they were having a Jefferson Bank commemoration, and she was talking to a young black man in a bank, and she was saying, well, you should know about the Jefferson Bank demonstration because that's probably why you have this job here today. And he said, oh, no. It, no, not me. I got this job on my own. And she said, she realized that we have to keep this history fresh in people's minds so they understand the people that battled before them and the people that made those sacrifices so that they could have a better life and have opportunities that they might not have otherwise. So I think these stories, these battles, they're important for people to know.
Thinking about the divisions, they're thinking about Ferguson. So can you talk about sort of, and I think when people hear number one in civil rights, I oftentimes hear people say, well, how can St. Louis say it has a great civil rights history? Look at what happened in Ferguson. Look at all these racial divisions. How do you talk about sort of current day and how that fits in?
Well, you know, people have said that to me, and I said, well, you know what civil rights is about. It's about fighting for your rights. It's a struggle for equality. It's a struggle against discrimination. It's not saying we have a racial paradise, because we don't have that anywhere, at least to my knowledge. and that's what it's about. To me, it's about the struggle. And there have been people that have struggled. One of the people that I usually like to talk about is Robert Witherspoon, because I don't want people to forget these people. And I might be getting away from your question, but I just got to include him. Because I think so many of these people we've forgotten about. And he's one of those people that many people have forgotten about. He was this very quiet lawyer, came here in the late 20s, early 30s. And he was involved in practically every civil rights case that was filed in the city of St. Louis. He was involved in the Gaines case. He sued the public school system because they had these two separate schools, one teachers' colleges, Harris for whites, Stowe for blacks. Sued Washington University because of their segregationist policies. Sued the city of St. Louis when they tried to resegregate the city pools at the Fairgrounds Park race riot. He was a lawyer for the Jefferson Bank defendants. I mean, he was everywhere doing everything. And this is a man that people, when I talk to people, they don't quite remember him. They have a better memory of his wife, Freda Witherspoon, who was quite a dynamo and was very much involved in a lot of things, too. He was also president of the NAACP during the time of the Fairgrounds Park race riot, or right after. So I wanted people to understand that this is about struggle, and that there were people who were struggling, people who made sacrifices. And I wanted them to be not just remembered, I want them to be honored and recognized.
You talk a lot about people like Witherspoon and others who had been forgotten. Mm-hmm. And you talk about in the exhibit things like the 1917 East St. Louis race riots, or even you just mentioned the Fairground Park pool riots, that I feel like are also largely forgotten. Mm-hmm. There are people who can't imagine Ferguson ever being forgotten. Does this exhibit sort of offer a bit of caution to that kind of?
Well, I think so. I think it does. And in fact, when we do include a segment on Ferguson, it's pretty hard not to. But one of the questions I pose, not just me, other people have posed this as well, you know, Ferguson, is this a moment or is this a movement? Because, like you said, so many other of these things have been forgotten. I hate to think that they've been forgotten, something like the East St. Louis race riot. And let me just clarify the term riot, because a lot of people are saying we shouldn't even use that word anymore because it's misunderstood in today's context. But when we're talking about the early 20th century, even when we're talking about as late as 1949 when the Fairgrounds Park race riot took place, what we're talking about when we say riot is whites attacking blacks, not sort of this Watts view of riots or the Ferguson view of riots or disorder. And I don't like to use that word anyway. It's maybe I prefer disorder. Some people say it's a rebellion, but whatever. But yeah, I think there is a danger that there's always a danger that we can forget our history. And I think that we have to keep this history alive And I think that's one of the things that exhibits can do, because they tend to be popular. I think they're visual. They can attract wide audiences. They're not necessarily like academic studies, where maybe you only get a chance to get a peek into this history if you're in a college classroom and taking a particular college course. My sister, who is an administrator at University of Missouri St. Louis and was also a professor at one time, often talks about students who, she says, have never taken a black history course, and she always encourages them to take a black history course. If they've never taken a gender studies course, and she encourages them to take a women's study course. So they know about groups that are generally not so much today, not so much today that these groups are marginalized or you know, assigned to the margins of history. They're fully integrated, I would hope, into into history today. But I think it's important that history is always front and center. And I'm always puzzled when people say, well, I don't like history. And I don't quite understand what that means. And maybe it's my blind spot, because I think history is fascinating. Everything has a history, and everybody has a history. So history is all around us. You can't ignore it. So it's important.
In this exhibit, you do some different approaches to telling that history. There are paintings, and there's live theater. Can you talk a little bit about why you did that approach here and sort of what it brings to the story?
Well, there are challenges when you do have an exhibit like this. I always say, in my curator role, when I have to go out and speak to people, one of my jobs is to try and bring in objects that will help us tell the story of African Americans in the city of St. Louis. And I always tell them, you know, the lifeblood of a museum is exhibits. In the lifeblood of exhibits or objects. And we usually have to rely on objects to tell that story. Now, we don't rely on, you can tell the story without objects, but they're very, very important to telling that story, and objects are an important part of history. So we had to rely on what we have, and we do have a lot. You know, we do have those oral histories. We have documents, we have photographs, and we do have some objects. And I must say, all of this was not my idea, of course, but the artwork that is going to become a part of our permanent collection, which again is an object. Portraits of those people that were so critical to the civil rights movement here in St. Louis, George Vaughn, Charlton Tandy, James Milton Turner, Pearl Maddox. So that was another way of telling us the story. Film is a way of telling the story. Music is a way of telling the story. There are lots of ways of telling a story. We do have a very creative theater piece that, of course, I cannot take credit for. But they're going to be actors who are going to be bringing these people to life. So there's a lot of ways to tell a story. And it's not always just objects. It's objects and other things.
We know that the visitors probably can't soak in all of that knowledge. At least on one visit, we hope they come back time and time again. But what is the, if visitors are just going to walk away with one idea or one fact or one piece of meaning, hope they read this.
Want people, and this is foremost for me, is I want people to understand that we did have a civil rights movement here, first and foremost, a very rich civil rights history, one that dates back to the early 19th century, and that has been ongoing, that these struggles have been ongoing, that African Americans and their white allies excuse me, as Judge Young has called them, were very intimately involved in fighting for the rights of African Americans, not only just in the city of St. Louis, but the city of St. Louis. We were a big city at one time. I always try and remind people we were a big city at one time. And what happened here did have a national impact. I want people to understand that as well. The other thing I wanted people to do, and this was foremost in my mind when I was doing a lot of the research, is that I want people to understand and to recognize those people that have made so many contributions. Somebody like a Bertie Beale Anderson that probably most people don't know as a civil rights activist. Maybe they know her as the head of Beale Mortuary. Charles Anderson, her husband, who had a lot to do with St. Louis U being desegregated. Cardinal Ritter, who just said, I'm not going to accept the parochial schools being segregated. And like I said, he issued an order, and just like that, the schools, parochial schools, were desegregated. It didn't take a Supreme Court decision. He just did it, and it happened. And of course, there were people like the Marco brothers, who are also Jesuit priests, William Marco and John Marco. Father Hightouse from St. Louis U, who railed against the fact that St. Louis U was segregated. I want those people to be known, along with the Robert Witherspoon, somebody like Percy Green, who has made tremendous sacrifices, Norman Say. These people are still alive, thank God, and I think we need to recognize them and honor them. I believe in giving people their roses while they're still alive and not memorializing them and talking about how great they are once they're no longer with us. So I want to memorialize those people in the past, and also I want to give praise and honor to those people who are still with us.
And do you think that there is people want to hear these stories? So sometimes anytime you bring up an issue that is difficult or complex, you have some people who, I don't want to talk about that, or race. You go out and talk to the community.
All the time.
Do you find that people want to hear these stories or wrestle with these
issues? You know, I have never gotten anything but positive feedback. Even when I flash the title on the screen, number one in civil rights, nobody ever says, oh no, that can't be true. They're interested. So maybe they say, we'll prove it. I don't know. But they're interested. They're interested, and they usually have a lot of questions. They show a lot of... they really show a lot of deep thought about these issues. And it's always positive. I've never gotten any negative response. Now, I don't think I'm preaching to the choir, because I'm going to different places. Now they know what I'm going to talk about in a broad general way, but not in a specific way. And this is a story, I think it's an uplifting story. I think it's a very uplifting story. It's about people that were fighting against injustice. And like I said, it's not one-sided. I was just reading Nathaniel Sweets talking about, no, it was Sidney Redman, I'm sorry, talking about Mayor Kaufman establishing the Race Relations Commission in St. Louis after Mayor Becker died. And he said, you know, I think it was great that he did this. He didn't have to do this. He might have left himself open to some criticism. But that's not a bad thing. Yeah. If you're doing something that is right, then you should expect criticism sometimes. And criticism, like I said, is not a bad thing. You have to accept the good with the bad. This is our history. And I think the important part is just telling the story. Some of our history is problematic. Some of our history is troubling. Some of it is causes elation. It's very positive, but it's all history. And I think you have to tell the story. You have to tell the whole story, the good, the bad, the ugly, because it is our past, and it is making us what we are today. You know, there's the quote from supposedly from James Baldwin, who says, you know, if you want to know what's going on around you, you have to know what's going on behind you. And it helps us to understand where we are now. If we don't understand our history, we won't understand our present or It won't help us to look into the future. So our history is important.
I think you addressed this a little bit earlier, but why do you think so much of this history has been forgotten?
That's a good question, because when I'm going back and I'm looking at somebody like Judge Young, who's writing about it in the St. Louis American newspaper, now he was writing about it, and this might be part of the problem. It's because for a long time, a lot of the major dailies, the Post-Dispatch, the Star Times when it existed, the Globe Democrat, they didn't pay a lot of attention to what was going on in the African-American community. They definitely didn't pay a lot of attention to civil rights issues. And if the only way you were going to know about what was going on as far as civil rights was concerned, even like those early CORE demonstrations, and CORE was an integrated group, and I think this is important too. In 1948, you had blacks and whites, primarily a lot of whites, forming this organization called CORE, where they decided to challenge segregation in eating places, primarily, and segregation in other places as well, in public accommodations. But they got practically no publicity. The Post-Dispatch later said, well, they didn't cover these stories because they didn't want to inflame the situation. They thought it would make it worse. Now, the St. Louis Argus and the St. Louis American covered these stories. But if you weren't reading those newspapers, you might not know any of this was going on. And I think that's part of the problem. It didn't get a lot of publicity. By the time 1960 rolls around, especially after 1954, it became almost impossible to ignore this. So for a long time, these things were just not reported on. People just didn't know about them. Definitely wasn't taught in our schools. And it's not that just local black history wasn't taught in schools. Just from my own growing up in St. Louis, I never knew anything about local history, period, because the focus was always on what was going on at the national level. So I think a lot of times we lose our local history. And I think with historians now focusing more and more on local history, they realize the importance of local history and these local stories, that's going to be less of a problem, I'm hoping.
So I know that there are four big cases that go all the way to the Supreme Court. I'm wondering if you could tell us each one and give us the brief synopsis of what happened and why it was so important or sort of lasting impacts.
Well, the first one is the Scott versus Sanford case, when Dred and Harriet Scott sued for their freedom based on the fact that they had lived in Illinois and at that time it was Wisconsin in those free territories, and it was based on a freedom suit. That was a case that went all the way to the Supreme Court, and of course Judge Roger B. Taney ruled that they were not citizens and therefore had no right to bring suit into a federal court. It was a national case. It was being followed very closely. And it is usually credited with pushing us even closer to civil war, because there was this tension about slavery, extending slavery into the territories or containing slavery. And when Taney said that the Missouri Constitution was unconstitutional, that you could not stop, the federal government could not say that slavery was not, could not be in the territories, it was a firestorm. So that was a very, very important case. And the Scotts were recognized celebrities in 1857 when that case was ruled on. They got a lot of national attention. And in fact, they appeared on, the first images of them appeared in Frank Leslie's, front page of Frank Leslie's magazine because of that. And they were local celebrities as well. So that was a very, very important case. That second case that we talk about is Gaines versus Canada, when Lloyd Gaines sued the University of Missouri because he wanted to enroll in the University of Missouri Law School. And of course, according to Missouri law, schools were segregated. This is a much longer story than I can go into here, but it was part of the NAACP strategy to end segregation, not just segregation in higher education, but to end segregation, period. In fact, there's a new book out by these two professors, Enzerby, I think, and Horner. And the title of their book is Lloyd Gaines and the End of Segregation. which they make this argument that this was the first important case that reached the Supreme Court that really challenged segregation. And it was a key plank in the NAACP strategy to end segregation that led up to the 1954 Brown versus the Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas. So that was a very, very important case. Of course, we have the Shelley versus Kramer case, which I've talked about, where the Shelleys sued based on the fact that there was a restrictive covenant that tried to keep them from taking possession of a home that they had built. And of course, that had important consequences for housing segregation throughout the United States, because now the Supreme Court didn't rule that you can have all the restrictive covenants you want, but they cannot be enforced. Because before, of course, they would use the courts to enforce these restrictive covenants. Well, you couldn't do that anymore. So it really changed the face of housing segregation in the United States. And of course, that fourth case, Jones versus Meyer, which attacked segregation in private housing and ended that. Of course, what happened is that we did have the Fair Housing Act that came, I think, shortly before that, so which outlawed that kind of segregation anyway. But it was still an important case that made an important argument.
So we know that tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people will come see this exhibit in the year that it's up on the floor. Who do you hope most sees this exhibit? Like, is there a group that you think, like, you know, I really want to make sure these people see this exhibit, learn these stories?
That's hard for me. Now, when I give this the talk, the presentation, a lot of people say, well, I really want young people to see this. I want them to know about this because there's a feeling, and I'm not convinced that that's the case, that they know less about the struggles that came before them. I think a lot of people my age might have forgotten those struggles. But I really would be pleased if young people did know about these struggles and the people that came before them. And I think there's a lesson here too that I think is for everyone. And I'm not gonna get political. But I think people need to understand the importance of collective struggle. You know, Martin Luther King talked about protest as being the voice of the voiceless. You know, Ralph Nader talks about the rumble from the people, and talking about how important it is to have this collective struggle, this collective protest. And we have to be vigilant. I don't think we can ever just sort of sit back and say, well, the struggle is over. I think Ferguson proves that we still have these issues that are problematic and that need to be addressed. And I hope that this particular exhibit demonstrates that, because it shows that people, whenever they saw an injustice, they tried to confront it. And I haven't been able to talk about everything that's in the exhibit and all the people. It almost feels like I'm slighting certain people or slighting certain events because there's things that I could not address. But I think it does show that people do not accept injustice. I also wanted to demonstrate, because I get a lot of this when I talk about these issues, they tend to think that African Americans in St. Louis were apathetic or docile or passive. And that goes back to, we did not have a civil rights movement here. And that is not the case. So I want to get rid of some of those misperceptions, or at least make a dent in some of those misperceptions or myths about our struggle here.
I think just in the last year, the African American History Museum opened in D.C.
Yes.
We are, you know, a 5-hour drive from Memphis, where you have the National Civil Rights Museum. Why is it important? You have these places where you can get this big story.
Oh, yes.
Why is it important for the Missouri History Museum to tell this St. Louis story?
Because it's our story, and I think it has been overlooked. I think it goes back to what I just said before, where people just deny that these things oh, I shouldn't say deny, or unaware that these things happened. And they see as St. Louis is somewhat different. I would almost hazard to say backwards, because that's a word I hear a lot as well. It's just what I hear. And like I said, I want people here to understand that we have a history we can be proud of. I mean, when Judge Young says we're number one in civil rights, I mean, that's a bold claim. When he said we have contributed so much to this national struggle, it's not just what we've done here locally, but what we've done here nationally. Every time you read about some movement here in St. Louis, like the March on Washington movement, there's a new book out about the March on Washington movement, in which the author says, who is a historian, a trained historian, he says that we had one of the most successful March on Washington movements in the country. Myron Rudwick's book on CORE talks about we had one of the most active, successful CORES in the country. The NAACP, they said under Sidney Redmond and Henry Espy, we had one of the most active NAACP chapters in the country. I don't think most people realize that. And that's not me saying this. These are these historians with their PhDs who have studied and researched this for years who are saying this. So I think that this is our history and this is our legacy, and it's something that we can be proud of. And we don't, I don't think it should be ignored any longer.
Well, so you talked about people with PhDs and the historians. I will say that there is no one who knows more about the long stretch of St. Louis civil rights history than you do, and I really appreciate that all that you've done to make this exhibit possible and to sit down with us today.
Well, thank you. And can I say one last thing?
Absolutely.
Okay. I just have to give credit to everybody that has been involved in this. I think my role is almost minimal. I did the research, but other people had to make it come to life. That's the designer. I can't even describe what the registrar does. The director of exhibitions and research, who is just a genius when it comes to really coming up with the way the exhibit should look and feel, and I don't know if you're going to cut this out or not, but I mean, there were so many people that have been so helpful, and it's almost feel like me representing this exhibition is somewhat not fair.
Well, you look the best on camera.
Well,
so
I'm not going to argue with that.
Well, thank you very much.
Okay.
I really appreciate it.
Okay.